فاللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا ووفقنا للعمل فيما يرضيك عنا بجاه نبيك المصطفى صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وبسر سورة الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Lord of the heavens and the earth. And we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon our Master Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, upon his family and companions and all those who followed after them with excellence up until the day of standing. Ameena, ameena, ameen. Thereafter we begin this lesson of ours by reciting Surah Al-Fatiha for all of those children who were massacred in the city of Peshawar, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises and elevates their ranks, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives comfort from His noble court to their parents, to their bereaved parents in this difficult time that they sent their children to school but they did not see a return of their children. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comforts those parents with His mercy, with His intimacy subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that He compensates for them their children with goodness in this world and the next world. Al-Fatiha. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alayhim ghayril maghdubi 'alayhim waladdallin. Amin. And we continue to read in the chapter of Kamal Hifzillah Ta'ala lahu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the book Al-Insan Al-Kamil, The Perfect Man sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, authored by our noble teacher, the Imam of Hadith, the Muhaddith of Haramain al-Sharifain, As-Sayyid Muhammad bin Alawi bin Abbas Al-Maliki Al-Makki radiyallahu ta'ala anhu wa nafa'ana Allahu bihi wa bikum ameen. Right at the beginning of the chapter, the Shaykh began with quoting verses from the Quran al-Kareem, in which Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects you from people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects you from people. So His guardianship and His protection was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The same way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took upon Himself to teach the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, He also took upon Himself to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as we read in the Quran al-Kareem that Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا. And He taught you all that which you knew not, and that was a great bounty and virtue of Allah's upon you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. الرَّحْمَنِ عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ خلق الإنسان علمه البيان. الرحمن, the merciful. الرحمن علم القرآن, He taught the Quran. To whom did He teach the Quran? He taught it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. خلق الإنسان, He created man. Now some of the scholars have said that here al-insan refers to all of mankind, but others have said that al-insan refers to the most perfect of mankind, the one who had all of the good qualities of manhood within him. This is what Allah is referring to when He says خلق الإنسان, that He created that being, He created that man who had all of the qualities of goodness within him, because that's what shows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's perfection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created all of us and He perfected our creation, as He said in Surah At-Tin, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. We surely have created man in the most best and the most beautiful of forms. But the most perfect of all of mankind was Sayyiduna Muhammad al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the scholars, when they explained خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ, we have two explanations for this. Either Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking in general and He's speaking about all of mankind, that He created all of mankind, or that the alif lam, or the definite article in al-insan, is referring to the pinnacle of perfection within mankind, and that's Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah Azza wa Jal began the surah with his blessed name, with his one of his personal names, Ar-Rahman. There are two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that cannot be taken up by anybody else, and they are Allah and Ar-Rahman. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal, in one of the final verse of Surah Al-Isra, Allah said, قُلِ ادْعُوا اللَّهَ أَوْ ادْعُوا الرَّحْمَانَ أَيَّمَّا تَدْعُوا فَلَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. Call upon Allah or call upon the Merciful. قُلِ ادْعُوا اللَّهَ. Say, call upon Allah or call upon Ar-Rahman. أَيَّمَّا تَدْعُوا. Whichever of the two that you call, i.e. whichever of the names that you use, فَلَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. For He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, are all of the beautiful names. So Allah said, Ar-Rahman, the Merciful, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ. He taught the Qur'an. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mention to whom He taught the Qur'an. But when Allah Azza wa Jal, He says He taught the Qur'an, then this perfect speech is directed to the most perfect of learners, who is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah said, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ. He created man. And again, that goes to the most perfect of man, of men. And that's Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Allah said, عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ. Then He subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-bayan, clarification, explanation for the Qur'an al-Kareem. So as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took upon Himself to teach the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي. My Lord nurtured me. My Lord educated me. فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي. And He gave me the best of education. He gave me the best of upbringing. And He gave me the best of nurturing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as Allah Azza wa Jal took upon Himself to educate and to teach the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, teach him the Qur'an, teach him the explanation of the Qur'an, Allah Azza wa Jal also took upon Himself to protect the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is manifest in his statement, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. And Allah protects you from people. Let's look at the beginning of this verse. Allah Azza wa Jal, in the entire Qur'an al-Kareem, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his attribute of Ar-Rasul, the Messenger, twice. He was addressed sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with this addressal twice. And both of the times are in the same surah. Both of the times are in the same surah. Allah Azza wa Jal, He said in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Both of the times are in Surah Al-Ma'idah. In this particular verse that we're dealing with, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ بَلِّغْ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ. O Messenger, deliver مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ, what has been revealed to you. O Messenger, deliver what has been revealed to you. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلْ فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَهُ. And if you don't do so, then you would have not propagated, and you would have not passed on the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You would have not done this. And then Allah said, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Don't worry about what's happening around you. Don't worry about the tricks and the plots and the evil traits of the people around you. Why? وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah shall protect you from all people. Right? So get on with your job. Get on with what you have to do. And that's propagating the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not worrying about the people who are around you, for Allah will protect you. And look at the times when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam needed the most protection. One of the times that he needed most protection was in the Battle of Badr. Look at the Battle of Badr. The companions, they leave Madinatul Munawwara, 313. Some have horses, some have camels. Most of them are walking. Most of them, they don't have any armor. They don't have any ammunition. They don't have any arrows, no bows, no spears, no swords, no shields. But they're going out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٌ. Surely Allah gave you victory on the day of Badr when you were empty-handed. أَذِلَّةٌ here means empty-handed. You didn't have anything to hand, but Allah still gave you victory. Why? Because Allah said, كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِئَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. How many of a small group have overcome a large group with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everything that goes on around us, as long as we realize that it's all within the control of the divine, it's all within the control of the merciful, it's all within the control of our Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have reliance upon Him, our affairs will become smooth. Allah said, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah protects you from people, from their ills, from their bads. Allah protects you. And a beautiful example of this is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam said to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu an, as Imam Muhammad ibn Muhammad Abu Shahba, the teacher of our teachers, he was the great muhaddith and scholar of Quran of Egypt, with whom our teacher, the muhaddith of Sham, Shaykh Nuruddin Itr, studied. So he's the teacher of our teachers. Shaykh Abu Shahba rahmatullahi alayhi, in his book on Seerah, he writes that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam said to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu one day, he said, oh Abu Bakr, don't you see how Allah has protected me? Oh Abu Bakr, don't you see how Allah has waiting protected, and he is listening to hear how Allah Azza wa Jal protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَذُمُّونَ مُذَمَّمًا وَأَنَا مُحَمَّدٍ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they are insulting مُذَمَّم with a dhal. They are insulting مُذَمَّم whilst I am Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because the people of Mecca, when they would want to insult, they didn't have the decency to even say the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but rather it wasn't them who didn't have the decency. It was Allah Azza wa Jal who did not allow for their tongues to articulate the name of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with any type of insult. So when they would want to insult, they wouldn't use his name Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would say Muzammam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, while I'm not Muzammam, I'm Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah said, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah protects you from people, from all types of people. Now, even though this verse of the Quran is revealed in particular for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the scholars of the science of Quran have said, if you read through the Quran al-Kareem, you'll see many verses that were revealed in particular situations, in particular scenarios, for particular people. Now the scholars have said, those verses that were revealed in such a manner, it doesn't mean that their application cannot be broadened to others. It doesn't mean that their application cannot be broadened to others. So this verse, even though it was revealed in particular for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those who seek protection in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through such like verses, Allah will also grant them protection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also grant them protection. And the next verse that the Shaykh mentions in this beautiful chapter of how Allah Azza wa Jal protected His beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in one of the final verses of Surah At-Tur, Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ فَإِنَّكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wasbir, and be patient, lihukmi rabbik, with the instruction of your Lord, the ahkam and the rulings that your Lord sends to you, be patient with them, apply them, practice them. Or, this is one of the meanings, and the other meaning is, wasbir lihukmi rabbik, be patient with that which your Lord decrees upon you. Everything that occurs is with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So be patient with it. And this is why the righteous and the pious, when calamities and difficulties strike them, they are patient. Why? Because they know that this difficulty hasn't come except from the one who is most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Except from the one who cares for them more than their own mothers can care for them. More than their own mothers can care for them. We were visiting the great Allama of Damascus, Shaykh Mustafa Turkmani Rahmatullahi Alayhi, and he was quite ill at the time when we were visiting him. He had a stroke. And we visited him with a Shaykh from Madinatul Munawwarah, Shaykh Abdul Qadir Al-Jili. And we sat in his house, and the Shaykh was reclining. And all the Shaykh that was saying, he was repeating an aphorism, a hikmah, a wisdom that Imam Ibn Ata'illah radiyallahu anhu mentions in his hikam. And that was, مَنْ ظَنَّ إِنْفِكَاكَ لُطْفِهِ عَنْ قَدَرِهِ فَذَٰلِكَ لِقُصُورِ جَهْلِهِ. Imam Ibn Ata'illah said, and Shaykh Mustafa was repeating this in his severe illness. He was extremely ill. And all he was saying to us was, anyone who thinks that Allah's decree is parted from his gentleness, anyone who thinks that his decree is parted from his gentleness, then that's due to his ignorance. So the Shaykh was trying to say to us, even though you see me in this state, don't think that Allah isn't more gentle with me than you. Don't come and give me comfort, for the one who has struck me with this difficulty, he is more gentle to me than you are. And I was amazed that this man is in such hardship. He had a stroke, and this is what he was repeating. So waters are tested at times of difficulty. When this difficult, it's all so easy reading out this hikmah in a lesson when we're all comfortable. But to repeat it when he's in such difficulty and in pain, to say, don't worry about me, for the one who has decreed this upon me, he is the most gentle, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ. Be patient with the decree of your Lord. Take it, swallow it. Swallow it like honey, because it's only come from your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Swallow it like medicine, for what will come after it will be sweet. What will come after it will be fruitful. Allah said, وَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ. And you know, to add on to the beauty of that speech, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed even more gentleness with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, comforted him even more, and he said, فَإِنَّكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا. Allah said, be patient with the decree of your Lord, for surely you are under our sight. You are under the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. Allah's merciful sight is gazing over you with his mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala. So nothing can really afflict you that will harm you. Nothing can really afflict you that will bring any type of evil to you subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah Azza wa Jal, in another verse of Surah Az-Zumar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِكَافٍ عَبْدَهُ. Isn't Allah enough for his servant? أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ. Isn't Allah كَافٍ, enough, sufficient, عَبْدَهُ, for his servant? And what's the reply to this? بَلَى. Indeed, he is enough for his servant. And this verse comforted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, gave him counsel that you're not all alone, you're with your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like he said to Sayyidina Abu Bakr in the cave, when Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu an was scared, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Messenger of Allah, if any one of them just looks up, he'll see our footsteps and he'll see that we've come in this direction of the cave of Al-Thawr. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr were migrating to Madinatul Munawwara, what was it that the Prophet ﷺ said to him? The Prophet ﷺ said to Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Ya Aba Bakr, ma zannuka bithnaini Allahu thalithuhuma. Oh Abu Bakr, what do you think of two? Allah is their third. What do you think of two people? That Allah is their third, i.e. you see me and yourself. But don't forget, Allah is the third of us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's me and there's you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees this situation, right? And he sees us and the difficulty that we're in. What do you think of two? Allah is their third. And this reminds us of the story of the people of the cave that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated. In Riyad Salihin, Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu mentioned that there were three men from amongst the people who went before us, right? And they were traveling and they stopped in a cave. And when they awoke, the mouth of the cave had been blocked by an enormous rock, and there was no way of them pushing through and escaping from this cave. So one of them suggested and said, let's all pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a good deed that we've ever done. So each of them thought of a good deed that they had done, and they said, oh Allah, for the sake of this good deed that I have done, allow us relief. And they said, when the first person made dua, the rock moved. Why? Because there was three of them, and Allah was their fourth, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first person made dua and said, oh Allah, I ask you for this particular deed that I did, and I did it with sincerity for your sake, the rock moved. When the second man made dua, the rock moved more. When the third person made dua, the rock moved enough for all three of them to escape. They didn't push it this time. They didn't push it. They didn't use their force. They turned to the absolute force, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it moved. Right? This is what Allah Azza wa Jal said in Surah At-Talaq. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. And those who fear Allah Azza wa Jal, and those who have God consciousness, those who are conscious that there's me, but there's also God. There's me, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is present with His knowledge. He's present with His sight. He's present with His hearing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah exists, and it is only His existence that is worthy to be in existence. This is why the scholars of Aqeedah, when they speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what do they say? Allahu wajibul wujud. Allah, His existence is necessary. As for our existence, jaiz al wujud. It's possible. If Allah wanted, so we are. If He didn't want, we wouldn't have been. Whereas that's not the case with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's case is, كان الله ولم يكن معه شيء. He was and nothing was with Him. And He is the way He was, and He will always be the way He is, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ. And those who fear Allah, those who are conscious that there's a God, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah makes leeways for them. Allah makes exits for them from their calamities and tribulations and difficulties. From where? مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. From ways that never passed their mind. Right? They never assumed that there would be an ease in this way, and suddenly Allah Azza wa Jal made an ease for them. They never thought that this difficulty will ever come to an end, and there, behold, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes ease for them in this difficulty. وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. And Allah grants them from His rizq. And rizq is not only what we eat and what we drink. That's not only rizq. Everything that Allah Azza wa Jal provides for us is rizq. Us sitting in this class is a rizq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has provided
for
us.
Could have been here without it
have been decreed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this rizq will come to us. This is rizq for us. This is a provision for us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides. He provides physical rizq, and He provides spiritual rizq for each and every one of us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِكَافٍ عَبْدَ. Isn't Allah enough for His servant? Bala. Indeed, Allah is enough for us. Allah is enough for us. Like the scholars say, Alhamdulillahi ala ni'matil Islam wa kafa biha min ni'mah. Praise be to Allah upon the ni'mah, upon the blessing of Islam, and it's enough of a blessing to have. That's it. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man radiya bil dhaqa ta'mul iman." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Dhaqa ta'mul iman man radiya billahi rabban wa bil islami deenan wa bi Muhammadin rasula," sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The one dhaqa ta'mul iman, he has tasted the sensation of iman." He has tasted the sensation of iman, right? Who? Man radiya billahi rabban. The one who is pleased with Allah as his Lord. Wa bil islami deenan. And as Islam, as his religion. Wa bi Muhammadin rasula. And with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as his messenger. How is it that we can be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was attended by Jibreel alayhi salam, and he said, Allah azza wa jal extends his salam to Sayyidina Abu Bakr. Allah extends his salam to Sayyidina Abu Bakr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ask Abu Bakr, is he pleased with me? Ask Abu Bakr, is he pleased with me? And when Sayyidina Abu Bakr heard this, he began to cry. He cried. Because the message wasn't coming from someone upon the earth. The message wasn't coming from mankind. The message wasn't coming from an angel. It wasn't coming from a prophet. It wasn't coming from a pious and a righteous. It was coming from the absolute. It was coming from the divine. It was coming from Allah, creator of the heavens and the earth. He turned to Abu Bakr and he said, are you pleased with me? Sayyidina Abu Bakr began to cry. And he said, who am I not to be pleased with Allah? Who am I not to be pleased with Allah? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْ. Allah was pleased with them and they were pleased with Allah. Why did Allah mention this? That they were pleased with Allah? To show a two-way relationship. That Allah is pleased with them, but they in return are people who are constantly thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Constantly in Allah, in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in a hadith Qudsi, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي. I am in accordance to what my servant thinks of me. And then the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah Azza wa Jal said, if my servant remembers me all alone, I remember him all alone. إِن ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِهِ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي نَفْسِي. When my servant sits and remembers me, and there's no one around him or her, and he's all alone, and he remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, in return, I remember him all alone. وَإِن ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرٍ مِّنْهُمْ. And if my servant sits amongst others and remembers me, then I remember him in a gathering which is better than their gathering. I remember him in a gathering which is better than his gathering. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِن تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ شِبْرًا تَقَرَّبْتُ إِلَيْهِ بَاعًا. And if my servant draws close to me a hand span, I draw close to him an arm span. And if my servant draws close to me, and if my servant walks towards me, my mercy comes running towards him. My mercy comes running towards him. Allah said, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِكَافٍ عَبْدًا. Isn't Allah enough, sufficient? Doesn't Allah suffice his servant? Indeed, he suffices us. He is enough for us. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'een. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, surely we have sufficed you those who mock. There were people around in Makkatul Mukarrama who would use foul language against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A beautiful hadith that I read only a few days ago in Mishkatul Masabih by Mullah Ali al-Qari radiallahu anhu. He mentions a hadith that there was a man, and he was a genuine man. He was a sincere, genuine man. And he hadn't heard about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he didn't know about the prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he heard in Makkatul Mukarrama that the people of Makkah are saying, وَالْعِيَازُ بِاللَّهِ, are saying Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mad. He heard the Meccan say this. He was genuine and sincere. He heard this from a number of people. And this man, he had a quality that he knew of a reading that he would read upon people who would have mental illnesses and they would be cured. He knew of a reading that he would read upon people who would have mental illnesses and they would be cured. So here he, from his sincere nature, went out in search of the Prophet ﷺ, not knowing that he is the Prophet of Allah. So he went out in search for him, and then he reached the Prophet ﷺ, and he said to the Prophet ﷺ, I've heard that you're not well. I've heard that you're not well and that you have some trouble, and I have a reading that if I do this reading on you, you will be cured. And the Prophet ﷺ listened to him. And then the man said to the Prophet ﷺ, what do you think? And listen to the reply of the Prophet ﷺ. The man said to the Prophet ﷺ, what do you think? Listen to the reply of the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ said to the man, Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu, wa nasta'inuhu, wa nastaghfiruhu, wa nu'minu bihi, wa natawakkalu alayhi, wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina, wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. The man said, what? He said, wow. He said, can you repeat that? And the Prophet ﷺ said, Alhamdulillah, نَحْمَدُهُ وَنَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُهُ وَنُؤْمِنُ بِهِ وَنَتَوَكَّلُ عَلَيْهِ وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنفُسِنَا وَمِنْ سَيِّئَاتِ أَعْمَالِنَا. مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. The man said, wow, can you repeat that? And the Prophet ﷺ said, Alhamdulillah, نَحْمَدُهُ وَنَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُهُ وَنُؤْمِنُ بِهِ وَنَتَوَكَّلُ عَلَيْهِ وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنفُسِنَا وَمِنْ سَيِّئَاتِ أَعْمَالِنَا. مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. The man said, whoa, I've heard magicians, I've heard the Arabs and their poetry, but I've never heard anything like this. They say you're mad? What fools they are. Extend your hand so I may accept Islam. He became Muslim immediately. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He came with a sincere heart, with a pure heart, that perhaps I can help this person. But in return, he found that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam helped him. صلى الله عليه وسلم فداك أبي وأمي يا رسول الله. Allah said, إنا كفيناك المستهزئين. We will suffice you those who mock. They were mocking, and within their mockery, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought benefit to people. The people accepted Islam. And we know the story of Abu Tufayl al-Dawsi رضي الله عنه. Abu Tufayl al-Dawsi was a businessman. He was a merchant from Yemen. And he was from the same tribe as Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, the famous companion. Sayyidina Abu Huraira was from the tribe of Ad-Daws. So was Abu Tufayl. But Abu Tufayl was from the leaders of the tribe because he was a rich businessman. And he would come to Makkah al-Mukarramah to do business. Every time he came to Makkah al-Mukarramah, the big lads of Makkah would meet him because he was somebody who came from another area. They would meet him and greet him and they would sit with him. And once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam announced his prophecy and messengership, and he came out in the open and he announced the religion of Allah azza wa jal, when Abu Tufayl came the next time, he came as usual and he met with the elite of Makkah. They greeted him and they met him and they said to him, Abu Tufayl, you're an intelligent man. We've had a problem in our city, and that is, there's a man whose name is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't listen to him. When you go and make tawaf around the Kaaba, he'll be there speaking to his people. Put your fingers in your ears and don't listen to him. Give him a deaf ear. Because, wal-iyazu billah, they used to say he's sahir. He's a magician. They used to say majnoon. So they said to Abu Tufayl, don't listen to him. Don't bother with him. Just get on with your business, make tawaf and come into the markets and do what you've got to do. Abu Tufayl said, fine. You know, these people, I always come and deal with them. They know better of their own people. They know better of what's going on in their lands. So Abu Tufayl went to make tawaf around the Kaaba. And what did he do? He put his fingers in his ear. He was making tawaf and he felt so stupid. He thought, what a man. He said to himself, Abu Tufayl, you're an intelligent man. Pull out your fingers from your ears and listen to what he's got to say. If it's good, that's fine. If it's not, carry on making your tawaf. So he pulled out his fingers from his ears and he began to listen to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to say. And he listened and he's listened. And those sweet words entered from his ears straight into his heart. Straight into his heart. And he accepted Islam. And he said to the Prophet ﷺ, Messenger of Allah, I want to stay with you here. And the Prophet ﷺ said, no, go back to your people, for you see the hardship that I'm living through. And when you see this matter of mine, i.e. this religion of Allah's, prevail, and the word has spread, then come back to me. So the elite of Makkah saw that Abu Tufail began to listen to the Prophet ﷺ, and they knew that anyone who listened to him with a sincere heart, that message would enter into that heart. They knew that. So they began to speak amongst themselves and say, that's it, he's gone. And when Abu Tufail came, they said, what happened? He said, he's a prophet of Allah. No one can stand before him. And they said, that's it. He's placed his spell on Abu Tufail also, wal-iyadu billah. It wasn't a spell. It was the miracles of the Muhammadan tongue, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Abu Tufail went back to Ad-Daws, to his tribe in Yemen. This is important now. When he went back to Ad-Daws, he didn't sit comfortably. He began to call the people of Ad-Daws to Islam, call them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his oneness, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Amongst those who accepted Islam early on with Abu Tufail Ad-Dawsi was Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu an. Sayyidina Abu Huraira became Muslim early on in the Meccan period. He only accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam later in the Medinan period for about 3 years of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's life. But that doesn't mean that's when he became Muslim. He became Muslim long before in the Meccan period. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam reached Madinatul Munawwara, Abu Tufail came to visit. And Abu Tufail said, Messenger of Allah, do you recognize me? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, you're the one who came to me in Makkah. So after 10 years or so, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam still recognized him and said to him, you're the one who came to me in Makkah. Yeah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'een. We will take care of those who mock. And one of the ways that Allah took care of those who mock, that they would mock, but the people who they would make their audience wouldn't believe them, wouldn't listen to them, right? And wouldn't be convinced what they say about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because they would see a total opposite in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from what they had mentioned to them about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this man, when he came, the Prophet ﷺ read the khutbah of Jum'ah to him, and he accepted Islam. He said, I've never heard words like this. These are just beyond, right? We've probably heard that khutbah so many times, it's just become a norm. But when the eloquent Arabs of the time of the Prophet ﷺ heard those words, they were striking, they were piercing, and they had never heard words like that. They were beyond their minds. This is why the scholars have said, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, he challenged the Arabs and he said, فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِّثْلِهِ. Bring a surah like the Quran al-Kareem. Bring a surah like the shortest surahs of the Quran. They were not able to. They gave up. Why? Because the Quran is mu'jiz. It's unmatchable in its nature, in its style, in its language. No one can match the Quran al-Kareem. If the Arabs at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave up, then no one's got any chance. No one's got any chance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذْ يَمْكُرُ بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And when the disbelievers plot against you, when they do makr, when they make mock of you, and when they try to plot against you, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Allah says, وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. And they mock, and Allah throws back onto them their mockery. Wallahu khayrul maakirin. And Allah is the best of those who throws back onto those who mock their mockery. Is that clear? Allah throws their mockery back onto them. They dig a ditch, but they're the ones who fall into that ditch. They plot and they plan against the Prophet ﷺ, but those plots and plans turn back onto them. Why? Because they're dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the Prophet ﷺ never ever took revenge for himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always dealt with that. تقول سيدتنا عائشة رضي الله عنها كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يحرس حتى نزلت هذه الآية. Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would be guarded. His house would be guarded. His tent would be guarded up until the time when this verse was revealed, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Wallahu ya'simuka minan nas. Allah protects you from people. So what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? فَأَخْرَجَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ رَأْسَهُ مِنَ الْقُبَّةِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took out his blessed head from his qubba, from his tent, and he said to the people, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, O people, انصرفوا, you may leave. فَقَدْ عَصَمَنِي رَبِّي عَزَّ وَجَلْ, for my Lord has took upon himself to protect me. I don't need any guards now. وروي أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا نزل منزلا اختار له أصحابه شجرة يقيل تحتها. And it is narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he would stop in his travels to take a break, his companions would choose a tree for him beneath which he would take the siesta, the day nap. Which is known as qaylulah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Qilu fa inna ash-shaytan la taqil." Take the siesta, take the day nap, for the shaytan doesn't take it. He's en route 24/7, right? So take this in opposition to him. Do everything that he doesn't do. Oppose him. So the Sahaba would choose a tree for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, beneath which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would take the siesta. Whilst the Prophet ﷺ was taking the siesta, فَأَتَاهُ أَعْرَابِيٌّ فَاخْتَرَطَ سَيْفَهُ. A Bedouin came over to the Prophet ﷺ and took his sword. ثُمَّ قَالْ مَنْ يَمْنَعُكَ مِنِّي. He took his sword and he said to the Prophet ﷺ, who's going to prevent you from me? So imagine, the Prophet ﷺ is lying down under this tree, and a Bedouin takes a sword, stands at the head of the Prophet ﷺ and says to him, مَنْ يَمْنَعُكَ مِنِّي? Who's going to prevent you from me? And the Prophet ﷺ said, اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. Allah, mighty and majestic, will prevent me from you. And what happened? فَأُرْعِدَتْ يَدُ الْأَعْرَابِي وَسَقَطَ سَيْفُهُ وَضَرَبَ بِرَأْسِهِ الشَّجَرَةَ حَتَّى سَالَ دِمَاغُهُ. Allahu Akbar. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the word Allah, the hand of this Bedouin trembled and his sword fell and his head struck the tree so hard that his brain burst out and he died instantly. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said Allah, the man's hand trembled, his sword dropped, and his head hit the tree so hard that his brain burst out. وَسَالَ دِمَاغُهُ. His dimag began to flow off his head. And he died instantly. Why? وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah protects you from people. صلى الله عليه وسلم. And something very similar occurred for one of the great scholars and one of the great awliya Allah who lived in our times, and he passed away a few years ago. He lived in Madinatul Munawwara for a very long time, and he was Palestinian originally. His name was Shaykh Namir al-Khatib rahmatullahi alayh. I didn't get to visit him, but my brother visited him, Shaykh Mohammed Qamar. And Shaykh Namir, our teacher in Damascus, Sheikh Fawaz al-Namir, told us that when he visited Sheikh Namir al-Khatib, he told us a story that when he was in Palestine many years ago, he said he was shot. He said he wasn't shot once. He was shot with a machine gun, with all of the bullets of that machine gun. He was shot in his chest with a machine gun and with all of the bullets of the machine gun. And he said, when the person shooting finished, he said, I shook my vest and all of the bullets dropped. He said, I shook my vest and all of the bullets dropped one after the other. And he was asked, how did that happen? And he said, I have a reading of a particular line of Qasidatul Burda every single day. And anyone who recites that line that particular number of times, Allah will protect them from all harm. And what's that line? وَمَنْ تَكُمْ بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ نُسْرَتُهُ إِنْ تَلْقَهُ الْأُسْدُ فِي آجَامِهِ تَجِمِهِ. Imam al-Busiri radiallahu anhu said, وَمَنْ تَكُنْ بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ نُسْرَتُهُ. And anyone who has his victory and has his help and assistance in the Messenger of Allah, إِنْ تَلْقَهُ الْأُسْدُ, even if he will be saved, he will be protected. The mouths of those lions will not be able to attack him. I can't remember the exact amount that Sheikh Fawaz told us that he heard. Sheikh Namr al-Khatib used to recite this line every single day. I can't remember. Wallahu ya'asimuka minan nas. Allah protects you from people. Allah protects you from people. وَقَدْ رُوِيَتْ هَذِهِ الْقِصَّةُ فِي الصَّحِيحِ وَأَنَّ غَوْرَثَ بْنِ الْحَارِثِ صَاحِبَ هَذِهِ الْقِصَّةِ. And this story has also been narrated in the Sahih, that the person who stood up to the Prophet ﷺ with his sword, his name was غَوْرَثَ ibn al-Harith. And this is another variation of the same story. Another variation of the same story. And perhaps this variation occurred at a different time. That the person of the story was غَوْرَثَ ibn al-Harith, وَأَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَفَى عَنْهُ فَرَجَعَ إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ وَقَالْ قَدْ جِئْتُكُمْ مِنْ عِنْدِ خَيْرِ النَّاسِ. In another narration of the story, it is that the man who stood up with the sword, his name was غَوْرَثَ ibn al-Harith. And when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Allah, this man retracted his sword. He retracted his sword and he apologized, and the Prophet ﷺ accepted his apology. Then the man went back to his people and he informed his people and he said, قَدْ جِئْتُكُمْ مِنْ عِنْدِ خَيْرِ النَّاسِ. I have come to you from the best of people, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I have come to you from the best of people. The person who has the most khair in him, that's whom I have come to you from, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. وَقَدْ حُكِيَتْ مِثْلَ هَذِهِ الْحِكَايَةِ إِنَّهَا جَرَتْ لَهُ يَوْمَ بَدْرٍ وَكَانَ قَدْ انْفَرَدَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِهِ لِقَضَاءِ حَاجَتِهِ فَدَبِعَهُ رَجُلٌ مِنَ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَذَكَرَ مِثْلَهُ. And this exact same story also has been narrated on the day of Badr, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam moved aside away from his companions to relieve himself, and one of the hypocrites followed after him and raised his sword in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and a similar story occurred with that hypocrite also. So this story of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being alone and somebody raising the sword towards him, it occurred a number of times. It occurred a number of times. وَقَدْ رُوِيَ أَنَّهُ وَقَعَ لَهُ مِثْلُهَا فِي غَزْوَةِ غَطَفَانِ بِذِي أَمْرٍ مَعَ رَجُلٍ إِسْمُهُ دَعْثُورِ بْنُ الْحَارِثِ. And it's also narrated that this same incident also took place in the battle of Ghatafan with a man whose name was Da'thur ibn al-Harith. That the Prophet ﷺ was alone and he raised his sword to him. وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ أَسْلَمَ فَلَمَّا رَجَعَ إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ الَّذِينَ أَغْرَوْهُ وَكَانَ سَيِّدُهُمْ وَأَشْجَعُهُمْ قَالُوا لَهُ أَيْنَ مَا كُنْتَ تَقُولُ وَقَدْ أَمْكَنَكَ. So Da'thur ibn al-Harith, he was alone with the Prophet ﷺ. He raised his sword to him and he said to the Prophet, who's going to prevent you from me now and from my sword? And the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah. And the man retracted and he accepted Islam. And then he went back to his people who had deceived him about the Prophet ﷺ. They had given him wrong information about the Prophet ﷺ. He went back to them whilst he was their leader and he was the most brave and the most courageous from amongst all of them. And they said to him, أَيْنَ مَا كُنْتَ تَقُولُ وَقَدْ أَمْكَنَكَ. Why is it that you've come back and you didn't do anything to him when you were able to? You were in a position that you were able to raise and use your sword against him. And the man, he said, إني نظرت إلى رجل أبيض طويل دفع عن صدري فوقعت لظهري وسقط السيف فعرفت أنه ملك وأسلمت. He said, when I approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when I approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with my sword, I saw before me rajul, a man. This wasn't the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what did he see? That between him and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he saw another man who wasn't physically there, but he saw another man, abyad, and this man was white, tawil. He was tall. Dafa'a an sadri. This man who was between me and the Prophet ﷺ, he pushed me from my chest. فَوَقَعْتُ لِظَهْرِي. So I fell on my back. وَسَقَطَ السَّيْفِ. And my sword fell from my hand. فَعَرَفْتُ أَنَّهُ malak. And I realized that this person who stood between me and the Prophet ﷺ and pushed me was an angel. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an angel to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he pushed this man away. He said, I realized that that was an angel that Allah had sent to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَأَسْلَمْتْ. He said, at that moment, I accepted Islam. He came with his naked sword, but he returned with his heart filled with Islam. وَقِيلَ فِيهِ نَزَلَتْ. And it is said, for this occasion, the following verse was revealed, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ هَمَّ قَوْمٌ أَنْ يَبْسُطُوا إِلَيْكُمْ أَيْدِيَهُمْ فَكَفَّ أَيْدِيَهُمْ عَنْكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, believing people, remember the time when Allah had His mercy upon you, His favor upon you. إِذْ هَمَّ قَوْمٌ أَنْ يَبْسُطُوا إِلَيْكُمْ أَيْدِيَهُمْ. When a people intended to extend their hands towards you, i.e. in war, in battle, in trying to attack you. When a people try to extend their hands towards you, فَكَفَّ أَيْدِيَهُمْ عَنْكُمْ. And Allah retracted their hands from you. Allah moved away and pushed away and wardened away their hands from you. This favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah said, اُذْكُرُوا. Remember this favor of Allah's. And it is said that this favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was at the battle of Ghatafan, when this man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam trying to attack him sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka wa sallam. وفي رواية الخطابي, and in the narration of Imam al-Khattabi radiyallahu anhu, إن غورث بن الحارث المحاربي أراد أن يفتك بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فلم يشعر به إلا وهو قائم على رأسه منتضيا سيفه. In another narration, Ghawras ibn al-Harith, he came towards the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم whilst the Prophet didn't realize صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he stood at the head of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with his naked sword, and he said, اللهم اكفنيه. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he saw him, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Allahumma kfinihi bima shi'ta." Allah said, "Oh Allah, suffice me this man however you wish. However you wish, move this person away from you. Suffice me his harm, his evil. You are enough for me. Suffice me his evil and his harm." فَانْكَبَّ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِهِ وَنَدَرَ سَيْفُهُ مِنْ يَدِهِ. The man fell upon his face and his sword dropped from his hand. وَقِيلَ فِي قِصَّتِي غَيْرَ هَذَا. And there are other narrations and variations of this story also. وَذَكَرَ أَنَّ فِيهِ نَزَلَتْ. And it is also mentioned that the following, the verse that we already mentioned, O believing people, remember the time when a people wanted to extend their hands towards you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moved away their hands from you, was revealed for this particular occasion. وَقِيلَ, and it is said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَخَافُ قُرَيْشًا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to fear Quraysh, because they were an evil people. They were tyrants. They were vicious. فَلَمَّا نَزَلَتْ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ اسْتَلْقَى ثُمَّ قَالَ مَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَخْذُلْنِي. When this verse was revealed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was relieved. He used to fear them. They were vicious, evil people. When this verse was revealed, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has removed their hands from you, istalqa. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was relieved. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever wants, then let him say whatever he wants, and let him do whatever he wants. Why? Because he knew Allah will remove their hands from him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects you from people. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. مولانا محمد حبيب رب العالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد فيقول الإمام الحجة شيخ الإسلام أبو زكريا يحيى بن شرف الدين النووي رضي الله عنه ونفعنا الله به وبكم آمين. قال: وأما الأحاديث فالأول عن ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: إن الصدق يهدي إلى البر وإن البر يهدي إلى الجنة. Imam al-Nawawi رضي الله عنه mentions the first hadith in the chapter of sincerity and truthfulness. And he says, on the authority of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is one of those companions who everybody, all of us should know very well. He was from amongst the scholars of the companions. He was amongst the early Muslims, one of the early Muslims, and he was from amongst the scholars of the companions. And even though he was a very short, thin man, but he was very courageous. When Surah Ar-Rahman was revealed in Makkah Al-Mukarramah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his Sahaba, who is it that will go and recite this surah besides the Kaaba and make all of the people of Makkah hear? All of the infidels and disbelievers of Makkah, they will hear this surah. Everyone was scared because they knew that they'd have to go and recite it in front of tyrants like Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, Messenger of Allah, I will. So he went and he recited, and Abu Jahl slapped Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud across the face and he ripped open his ear. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. He ripped open his ear. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Messenger of Allah, look what he's done to me. Look what he's done to me. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at him and he smiled. And the Prophet Sayyidina Abdullah said, Messenger of Allah, you're smiling. He said, don't worry. Jibreel has just told me something. Don't worry, Jibreel has just told me something. Years later in the battle of Badr, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud comes to the Prophet ﷺ at the end of the battle and said, Messenger of Allah, I don't think I gave the battle my full. I feel I didn't participate as I should have. The Prophet ﷺ said, go look around at the casualties. And if you find anyone who's still got any breath in them from amongst the enemy, then they're yours. So he walks around and who does he find? Abu Jahl. Yeah? He finds Abu Jahl. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was a tiny man. He sat on his chest, right? Abu Jahl couldn't move. He was a tonk, giant man. He sat on his chest and he was such such a lowly man that even when he could see his death imminent, he was still insulting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud finished him off, right? And he wanted to carry his head to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud couldn't carry his head because he was a tiny man. So what did he do? He tied a rope to his head and he pulled it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled and he said, "This was for that day. When he slapped you then and split your ear open, this was for that day." And Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, his shins were extremely thin and skinny. And one day his lower garment, his izar, moved from his shins, and the Sahaba saw how skinny his legs were and they began to laugh. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam heard them laugh and he said sallallahu alayhi wasallam that his legs are more heavier upon the scales with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the mountain of Uhud. more heavier than the mountain of Uhud. Why? Because he had accompanied the Prophet ﷺ. Why? Because he was a man of knowledge. He was a man of knowledge. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. And you know how pleased the Prophet ﷺ was with him? The Prophet ﷺ said, رَضِيتُ لِأُمَّتِي مَا رَضِيَ لَهُ إِبْنُ أُمِّي عَبْدٍ. The Prophet ﷺ said, I am pleased for my ummah, whatever Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is pleased for my ummah for. Anything that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud decides for my ummah and he's pleased with it, I'm pleased with that. So imagine that. That the Prophet ﷺ says to his companion, says to his student, whatever you decide, I'm pleased with it. I'm happy with it. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu narrates from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that he said, "Inna as-sidqa yahdi ila al-birr." Surely, truthfulness and sincerity leads a person to goodness. Leads a person to goodness. Which means what? That somebody who's got a good heart, they will be led to goodness. Somebody who's got a good heart, they will be led to goodness. When Sayyidina Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu accepted Islam and he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, after he accepted Islam, what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Khalid, I knew that your sound intelligence would bring you to Islam. Your sound intelligence would bring you to Islam. This is why what's extremely important is that people are sincere in their heart. Actions might be little. Actions might be little. But if they have goodness of the heart behind them, Allah magnifies those actions and makes them enormous. But on the other hand, if someone does a lot of things, has a lot of actions, but they're not sincere in their heart, they have hatred in their heart, they had enmity in their heart, they have animosity in their heart, they have jealousy in their heart, they have envy in their heart, they have all of these illnesses in their heart, their actions, however great they are, they'll be meaningless, they'll disappear, they'll fade away, they'll be blown just in air, they'll disappear. So what's extremely important is that we have sincerity in our hearts. We have sidq, we have truthfulness in our hearts. And when we have truthfulness in our hearts, that truthfulness will drive us towards goodness. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَإِنَّ الْبِرَّ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. And that goodness that is an offshoot of sincerity, that goodness leads people to paradise. وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَصْدُقُ حَتَّى يُكْتَبَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ صِدِّيقًا. And a person constantly is sincere and truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares that person to be a siddiq. And what's a siddiq? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. Allah said, أُولَٰئِك, and they are those upon whom Allah had His favor and His blessings from amongst the prophets, the Siddiqeen. Siddiqiyya is a rutba, it's a rank which comes straight after prophethood. This is why Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was known as a Siddiq, because after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and after all of the prophets, he is the most high ranking believing person in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the scholars have defined Siddiqiyya in a beautiful way. The scholars have said, when someone is truthful, someone is sadiq, truthful, that means what they say is in accordance to what appears before your eyes. What they say is in accordance to what appears before your eyes. So they dictate with their tongue what reality says. Whatever is in reality, they dictate it with their tongues. Scholars have said, that's a sadiq, that's someone who's truthful. But siddiq is a person who, when he says, his statements dictate reality. His statements dictate reality. An example of this is that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back from Mi'raj and he told the people that he had been to Jerusalem and he had been to the heavens within one night and he had returned, they came to Sayyidina Abu Bakr and they said, you heard what your companion, your friend is saying now? That he's been to Jerusalem and back in one night, and he went to the heavens and he came back. What did Sayyidina Abu Bakr say? He said, if he said it, then I believe him. If he said it, then I believe him. Right? So Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anh is giving a statement that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whatever he says, he's the most truthful. And siddiqiyya is to say something which becomes reality. Truthfulness is to say what is reality. But siddiqiyya is a higher level, is to speak and that becomes reality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes that the reality of what's happening. Another example of this is that the Prophet ﷺ was traveling, and from a distance he could see one of his companions approaching towards him. And the Prophet ﷺ said, be so and so. Be so and so. Be such and such a person. When that person approached and he reached the Prophet ﷺ, he was the exact person that the Prophet ﷺ wanted. And this is siddiqiyya. What's siddiqiyya? That when a person speaks, their speech dictates reality. It dictates what's happening upon the ground. Is that clear? So Allah, the Prophet ﷺ said, when a person is constantly truthful with Allah, Allah makes that person's tongue such that whatever they say becomes reality. Whatever they say becomes what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. And then the Prophet ﷺ spoke about the opposite and he said, وَإِنَّ الْكَذِبَ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْفُجُورِ. And lying, kazib, lying, leads towards, drags a person towards fujur, transgression, sins, disobedience, evil. وَإِنَّ الْفُجُورَ يَهْدِي إِلَى النَّارِ. And fujur, transgression, evil, disobedience, leads a person to the fire. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَكْذِبْ حَتَّى يُكْتَبَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَذَّابًا. And a person constantly lies, one lie after the other, one lie after the other, such that he is declared a kazzab, an extreme liar with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kazzab is the most emphatic nature of a lying person. A kazzab, he is known to be an extreme liar. We seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from such a state. And the scholars have said, we take from this hadith, at-targhibu fi sidq, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is encouraging us to constantly be truthful. This is why I say to the kids in class, if they do something wrong, I say to them, look, if you speak the truth, you'll get away with it. It will pile up on you, one after the other. Just speak the truth and you'll get away with it. And that's when they realize, okay, let's give in. They give in, they apologize, they regret, and they know that truthfulness has saved us. But when you see them, okay, trying to find ways of lying, trying to find, you can see it on their faces. And you say to them, look, speak the truth and you'll get away with it. Lie, and it's just going to be trouble after trouble after trouble. Is that clear? Why is it that the Prophet ﷺ is encouraging us and towards sidq and truthfulness and sincerity? لِأَنَّهُ سَبَبُ كُلِّ خَيْرٍ. Because it is the reason and the means to all goodness. All goodness that reaches anyone, it's through sincerity that you have, the goodness of your heart. وَالتَّحْذِيرُ مِنَ الْكَذِبِ لِأَنَّهُ سَبَبُ كُلِّ شَرٍ. And the Prophet ﷺ is warning us against lying. Because lying is a state which drags a person towards all evil. وَأَنَّ مَنِشْتُهِرَ بِشَيْءٍ صَحَّ أَنْ يُصَفَ بِهِ. And a person who becomes famous with anything, they will be characterized with that. So if a person becomes famous to be truthful, they'll be characterized, he was a truthful person, and likewise the opposite. الثواب والعقاب يترتب على ما يقوم به الإنسان من عمل خير أو شر. The scholars have said that reward and punishment is based upon what? Reward and punishment is based upon that which a person does of goodness and evil. That which a person does of goodness and evil. عَاقِبَةُ الصِّدْقِ الْجَنَّةِ. And the end result of sincerity and truthfulness is paradise. وَعَاقِبَةُ الْكَذِبِ النَّارِ. And the end result of lying is the fire of hell. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, one of the signs of a hypocrite is that he lies. Every time he speaks, he lies. His speech is full of lies. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the purest, and he was the clearest and the cleanest from lies, wal-iyazu billah. He was the purest sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is why when he went to Madinatul Munawwara, and the Jewish rabbi Abdullah ibn Salam radiyallahu an saw him for the first time, he said, when I saw his blessed face for the first time, the first statement that came to my mouth was, Laysa biwajhi kazzab. This is not the face of a liar. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik alayhi. He said, this cannot be the face of a liar. Why? Because the beauty and the nur and light that emanated from that blessed face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, spoke for itself. Spoke for itself. Now, this is why the scholars have said, if you have a need, then find a... If you have a need and you need to find someone to help you with that need, find someone to look after you in that need, they say, find someone with a beautiful face. Find somebody with a beautiful face. And beauty of the face is what? Beauty of the face is to be a face that reflects the face of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That's beauty in a face. A face that has the light of Islam shining in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the faces of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and he said, سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ. Their signs are in their faces from the effects of prostration. So beauty, they say, find someone with a beautiful face. Why? Because the beauty of their heart is now shining upon their face. The beauty of their heart is now shining upon their face. الصدق يكون بالقول المطابق للواقع. And what's sincerity and truthfulness? That a person's statement is in accordance to reality, to what's going on the ground. وبالفعل في أدائه على أحسن وجه. And sincerity in action is to undertake an action in the most beautiful and in the best of ways. الثاني, the second hadith. وعن أبي محمد الحسن بن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنهما قال. The second hadith is on the authority of Abu Muhammad al-Hasan, Sayyidina al-Hasan, the grandchild of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the son of Sayyidina Ali, the son of Abu Talib, may Allah be pleased with both of them. He said, حفظت من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك فإن الصدق طمأنينة والكذب ريبة. رواه الترمذي وقال حديث صحيح. قوله يريبك هو بفتح الياء وبضمها ومعناه اترك ما تشك في حله واعدل إلى ما لا تشك فيه. سيدنا الحسن رضي الله عنه said, I heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that he said, حَفِظْتُ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. I memorized from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, دَعْ مَا يَرِيبُكْ. Leave all of that which you have doubt in. إِلَى مَا لَا يَرِيبُكْ. To that which you have no doubt in. If you have doubt in something, just leave it. Move back. Find something else. Go to something else that you don't have doubt in. Why? فَإِنَّ الصِّدْقَ تُمَأْنِينَ. For truthfulness and sincerity is tranquility. Truthfulness and sincerity is tranquility, which means what? That if you're having doubt in something, that means you're not having tranquility and peace, which means there's something iffy about this. There's something dodgy about this. So leave it. And when you leave it towards that which you have no doubt in, what will come to your heart is tuma'nina. And based upon that tuma'nina, go ahead. Follow on. Wal-kathiba riba. And the Prophet ﷺ said, and lying is riba, is doubt. When a person has doubt, then there's something dodgy going on. There's something iffy going on. Then there's something wrong going on. Which means what? That we with our human natures can work out what's good and what's bad. We have an intrinsic inclination in deciding what's good and what's bad. right? So if we feel, if we have doubt in something, we should move away from it. Why? Because doubt is only brought about by incorrect things. Whereas if we have certainty about something, that's only brought about through truthfulness and sincerity. The scholars have said, "As-sidqu yab'asu fi nafsi sahibihi at-tuma'nina fil qalbi wash-shuja'a wa 'izzatu an-nafs wa thiqatu an-nas bihi." That sincerity brings about, truthfulness brings about tranquility in a person's heart, shuja'a. When a person is certain about something, they're brave. They're not going to be coward. They're not going to chicken away from it. They're going to be strong about whatever they believe in their heart. وَعِزَّةَ النَّفْسِ. And they will have honor within themselves. Whereas lying, a person might be able to lie to others, but deep down within their own conscience, they're guilty. Whereas truthfulness, there's no guilt. A person has bravery on the outside and عِزَّةُ النَّفْسِ and honor within themselves. وَثِقَةُ النَّاسِ بِهِ. And people rely upon such a person and depend upon such a person. وَالْكَذِبْ. Whereas lying, it brings about in a person shak, brings about doubt, taraddud, hesitation, khawf, fear, zul, lowliness, zul, dishonor, hawan, lowliness, sigar, to feel belittled, wa'adam siqat an-nas bihi, and not having the reliance of people upon oneself. So the Prophet ﷺ said, As-sidqu tuma'nina. This is one of the best fruits of truthfulness that we can pick and we can have the sensation of whilst we live upon the earth, which is when we're truthful and when we're sincere, we'll feel tranquility and peace and comfort in our hearts. And when we lie, we'll feel fear, we'll feel low, we'll feel dishonored, we won't have honor, and we won't have reliance upon ourselves, and people won't have reliance upon us. So the Prophet ﷺ said, leave that which you have doubt in to that which you have no doubt in. For truthfulness and sincerity is tranquility, and lying is doubt. And the next hadith is on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Sufyan, Sakhr ibn Harb, radiyallahu an, which we will read inshaAllah in the next lesson, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us life. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Al-Fatiha.